are you looking at? And we're going to look at durability and how those two come into play together. Before we get into the meat of today's lecture, I want to make a few announcements. So first off, I said I'd let you know when the 662 waitlist was up. It is, I was just informed this morning that there is now a waitlist, so you can sign up there. I can't force register every single person who has asked to be registered into 662. I will force register up to 10 students. I'm going to require that you get a B+ in this course, so I will force register after the grades are in. And if more than 10 people are eligible for this, then I will pick based on a weighted average of your project and exam grades, most likely a 50-50, but that might be skewed a little bit to make them follow the same curve. So, the other thing I want to bring up is the final exam. So we had a bit of a poll to figure out whether people wanted it on the last day of classes. There was pretty much an overwhelming response when I checked. There is an overwhelming response for having it in class, so that is what we're going to do. If this is a problem for you, then please get in touch with me directly and we'll make some sort of arrangements for you as well. All right, so that all being said, let's get into the meat of what we're going to talk about today. So let me ask you, what does it mean when we say a transaction is committed? We talked about transactions the last few classes, and one of the things the transaction can do is commit. Commit work and abort. What does it mean for the database to say this transaction is committed? The changes are permanent. Okay, so there's some sort of permanence associated with it. What else? So we want to make sure that those changes don't go away. And there's various ways to which you can guarantee that. But what else? Could you say that again?
Initially, you have more changes. Do you know what are the changes?
So I'm not sure. There could be some history, some record of what changes were made. But I mean, in some sense, that's not necessarily part of commit itself. It's granted, you want to know that the transaction is committed fully, you want to know that the transaction's effects are visible, but the history of those effects is maybe not necessarily part of the definition of the transaction in itself. It might be a nice feature to have, but not part of the core definition. And what else do you expect to see out of a transaction? Well, okay, let me give you guys one thing. I would like all of the transactions to be reported. The database tells me that the transaction is committed, then I'd better expect to see the entire transaction fully there, all of its effects fully visible, and the rest of the, anytime I try to access something. I'd also like to know that the transaction's effects were correct. This is what we talked about in the last few classes. So another way to kind of get across what ACID is, if the database tells you that the transaction has successfully committed, that means that the transaction happened in its entirety, that the transaction, it left the database in a stable state, that you didn't break any of the data constraints that you want to see on the database, that the transaction executed safely, we talked about this in the last few classes, and that the transaction is safe on disk. Safety kind of has adopted a variety of different meanings, but the one we're going to use is that it can survive some degree of failure. Now, obviously, there's if a T-Rex comes in and eats your data center, and that's where all of your data is, then I mean there's a limit to durability. But we want to be able to say that to provide some guarantee that if something breaks, the system can come back up and be able to restore the database to a consistent state. And when the system says, congratulations, your transaction is safe, it's durable, then that means that the transaction will be, in effect, visible. The effects will be visible as long as some part of the database is still running, or still able to run. And I want to make a very clear distinction, because there's actually two different commit events. There's the point at which the transaction says it would like to commit, and there's the point at which the database returns and says, congratulations, your transaction is committed. Those are two separate things. If the commit returns successfully, then everything is good. Your transaction is visible, it will survive anything short of a T-Rex attack. If the commit is registered, if the transaction says it wants to commit, but the database hasn't agreed that the transaction has successfully committed, then you don't actually know. The database has a little bit of leeway here. Until it actually returns, the transaction's effects may be visible forever, but they might not. Essentially, the transaction saying, I would like to commit, is the point at which the transaction is happy to have its data visible for the rest of eternity. I want to make that very clear, that kind of there's before commit is called, the transaction's effects will not be visible. After commit returns, the transactions will be visible, but that kind of intermediate state, that intermediate space, is one where the database might or might not have finished recording. Okay, so today we're going to talk about durability, and I want to motivate this with a bit of an example. So I've got five transactions here, and time goes from left to right. So transaction one and transaction four start at some point. Time goes on a little further, transaction two starts up, transaction one and four keep running, then at some point transaction one finishes, maybe transaction three starts up, then maybe at some point transaction five starts, transaction two finishes, moving, time goes on, maybe transaction three finishes, and then time goes, and bam, the system crashes. Or the database has some sort of failure, maybe there's a bug, maybe it's power failure, something goes wrong, and the database stops at this point. So what should happen? When the database comes back, what should it be showing to any clients? Okay, so transaction one, two, and three, they committed, they're done. And I'm gonna say that the database returns, told them, congratulations, you're done. Those transactions should be present when the database resumes. The other transactions, whatever they did, whatever they wrote to the disk, whatever they modified, we should be able to undo all of that. Right. So how does this interact with the ACID properties that we just So isolation, well, you know, we already talked about how isolation, how transactions can be isolated from one another. So we're going to assume that all of that, all of the mechanisms for ensuring consistency through either optimistic concurrency control, locking, or multi-version timestamp, or multi-version timestamp concurrency control are in place. The system's already using those. We don't have to necessarily care about isolation. So we need to ensure atomicity. And that means that either all of the transactions' writes, all of the things that the modifications that the transaction applied to the database are visible, or none of them are visible when the system comes back up. And that's a bit of a problem because most file systems don't actually give you that level of control. At the very least, you might be able to get back that the writes are, individual writes are atomic. But even then, that's not always necessarily the case. So we need to make sure that when we write stuff to disk, that we can basically get the database back to a stable point, either before or after the commit. We'll get to that in a moment. Durability. Durability is a bit of a problem for a couple of different reasons. The big one being that there's, even in most major database systems right now, you're going to be modifying a very large amount of data, and you may not necessarily have enough memory to modify, to buffer all of the changes that the database is actually trying to keep track of. You might need to free up memory, and so those buffers might need to go back onto disk. Even if that's not a problem, you may still want to write things to disk. If you are reasonably certain that a transaction is going to commit, you may actually want to write those values back to disk just so that they're there and you can perform the commit a lot faster. And then you also want to ensure consistency. So if a transaction gets aborted, or if a transaction, if the system crashes in the middle of a transaction, we need to be able to go back to an earlier version of the values that the database is seeing. Those values might have been back to disk or not. So today we're going to look at a couple of techniques that go into solving mostly these three problems: atomicity, durability, and consistency. So let's start with atomicity. And the fundamental problem, as I said, was that IOs, generally, you can only assume that they're atomic for one page. Say, write this page to disk, you can assume on most hardware, and even there, it's a little bit sketchy, you can assume that the IO will either happen entirely or happen not at all. But we want to provide that same level of abstraction, but for multiple IOs. And the fundamental problem here is what happens if the system has a power failure, or T-Rex is only the network cable in the middle of the write process. And the solution that we're going to put out today, or the approach that we're going to take to this, is to essentially log all of the things that we're going to do. So in effect, we're going to perform every write twice. Once, we're going to, at the very beginning, keep a log of everything that we did. And then as we log things down, we can then start actually performing the modifications to the data that's the actual data representation that we want to work. If you're familiar with journaling file systems, this is exactly the same principle. A lot of what we're going to talk about will be very familiar. Durability and consistency, both of these kind of deal with the same kind of fundamental problem. We want to be able to kind of undo stuff that has happened. So we may need to perform writes before we can actually, we may need to write data back to disk, to our primary storage, before we are actually sure that a transaction is actually going to commit. So in addition to logging things, we need to kind of do some sort of extra log juggling in order to be able to essentially undo changes that we mistakenly wrote to disk. So the two fundamental techniques that we're going to talk about today are two different logging strategies. One for providing atomicity, and the other for providing consistency and durability. So, any questions so far? All right. So, let's tackle these one at a time. So first, we want to be able to ensure atomicity, ensure that the data stays intact, even if the system fails in the middle of a write. So like I said, you can't necessarily assume this for all hardware, but we're going to adopt a slightly simplified model where we're allowed to write at least one page. If the hard disk tells us this page is fully written, it's on disk, it's safe, it's persistent, and this generalizes to more complex settings like distributed systems, where not actually telling you what medium we're using here. The medium is a disk, right? If the medium is another computer, then many of the same things apply. There's basically the main problem that, as I said, the main problem that we're trying to address is that the main two problems that we're trying to address are if the system crashes while we are actually trying to write something to disk, we need to make sure that when the system comes back, either everything that got written we're able to undo it, or we're able to restore the system to a state either before or after a sequence of writes. And making the issue a little more difficult is the fact that we might need to buffer things, we might need to write things out to disk as they're buffered, or we may need to keep things in buffer, just improve in a buffer to improve performance. This is kind of abstract, so let me give you a more concrete example. One particular solution. So I've got a database here. About five different objects, integers here, but you can think of them as rows, or you can think of any sort of database object that any sort of structure that you want to atomically be able to update. Before we perform any sort of modification to the database itself, the data that's sitting on disk, we're first going to record an entry in the log says what we want to do. So if we want to perform a write, we want to modify A over it with the value of 10, the first thing we're going to do is first write a log entry saying we're about to write 10 to A, and then once we know that this is safely on disk, that this has been safely flushed to disk, then we can actually perform the write on the value. Nice thing about this is that the log, we're always going to be appending to the end of the log, and because of that, it's usually quite a bit cheaper to append values to a file than it is to actually write randomly. And this is still true for flash media. because you can do all sorts of buffering tricks that you wouldn't be able to do with you can do all sorts of buffering tricks. So writes are generally going to be fairly efficient, and as a result, random writes, what would normally be random writes to the disk, end up being, in order to preserve in order to preserve the atomicity of the operations, or to make them durable, we can do much more efficient append-only writes to the log, and we can kind of buffer the values that would go to disk. We don't actually have to flush them to disk immediately, because as long as these values are safely on disk, then we know that the data values can be recovered. The data values in the database that can be safely recovered. Questions? Yeah.
So when you're writing E, you're overwriting E. What transaction needed the previous value of E?
Ah, okay. So this is a question about multi-version concurrency. So if if we use any of the concurrency control schemes other than multi-version concurrency control, this works more or less out of the box. If we use multi-version concurrency control, then what would normally happen is that you create a new object, a version whatever, and each of these objects would have a pointer going back to the last version of that object. So then we'd actually have to not just create A, but we'd have to create a new object, A prime, with a value 8, and then A would have a pointer back to A prime. Does that address your question?
Yeah, and when you're saying it's going to be appended to the log, this part is the log or just that is the log?
This is the log. This is the clustered, this is the data representation.
On disk.
Or this is the data representation, this is the data representation that would go to disk. We want to keep essentially two copies of this. We want to keep one actually on disk, and we keep one in memory as a sort of cache. Not every, yes. So we'll get to this in a little more detail later on. But there's a component of a database called a buffer manager that basically keeps track of everything that's being cached. So you've got essentially every page that is on disk is stored associated with a bunch of metadata, and then the actual data that should be mirrored to disk. The buffer manager has the option of not necessarily taking every data, every value that. The advantage to using something like a buffer manager is that you don't necessarily need to take all of your data and immediately send it back to disk. You can take, if there's, let's say, two writes to page 24, those writes can be batched together, and then you only have to perform one write back to. Is that first question? Yeah. Well, so the buffer manager keeps individual pages. You're not going to keep the entire database in memory. The buffer manager basically picks out which pages of the database you actually need to keep in memory. And this kind of behaves like virtual memory. When the system decides that, or when the system runs out of memory, it's basically going to look at the buffer manager, find a page that is safe to remove from memory, and say 30, for example. 30 is nothing's been changed, so it would just say, okay, 30, you're out of memory, and whatever other thing it had to load, it would just replace the memory would go into the slot that they're using. Is that the correct question?
So when they come back to the 40 pages control, then the 30 pages would be like yours, right?
Exactly. And that's why you want to build a lot to keep track of this in two.
You know, how could we identify that particular point, like from where we need to start the execution in order to come back to the latest point? Do we write only the latest notes or do we keep track of the entire log?
That is an excellent question. We will get back to that a little bit later today. So the question, to rephrase it slightly, is how much log do you need to keep track of? Obviously, as you keep building up the log, it's going to get longer and longer, and the older the database is, the bigger this log structure is going to be. There is a point at which you can start throwing away the log, and we will hopefully get to that later today. Good question. All right, so just to give you a general sense of what goes into one of these log entries, every log entry is going to be associated with some sort of transaction. We want to keep track of what the log entry is representing, because in addition to doing writes, we might want to log a couple of other types of events. And we're also going to keep track of all of the log entries in a kind of reverse linked list. So every transaction, every log entry is going to have a link to the last log entry created by the same transaction. Visualization of that. It's going to have a link back to the last transaction, so you can basically skip through the log, finding just the log entries for the transaction for a specific transaction that you're looking for, and this will be relevant. And then obviously there's some sort of payload for the log entry. If there's a write, that's what goes there. If there's a commit. So this approach of logging everything gives us durability, because as soon as this log is safe on disk, and log is very easy to get out to disk because it's append only, as soon as this log is out on disk, and as soon as we know that this log is safe on disk, then we know that all of the transactions effects will be permanent, or will be reconstructible. Because we can always go through this log, we can replay all of the operations. The log gives us enough information to reconstruct what is in the buffer manager if a crash should occur before those values can get out to disk. So the other thing that we wanted to be able to support was rollback. When a transaction aborts, we want to be able to undo the things that transaction. And this means either whether the transaction aborts naturally or whether it aborts because there was a crash before the transaction committed. So there's a couple of different ways that you could represent this. And kind of, if we're talking about a single buffer manager, a single backend database file, then we have a couple of different problems. So a couple of operations here, two transactions both simultaneously running. One modifies A, one modifies B. One modifies A, then E, then B again. Transaction 1 commits, and now transaction 2, aborts. So in effect, the problem that we're trying to address is how do we go back to an earlier version of a value that we threw away because we didn't think it was going to be useful. And one strategy that you are already probably quite familiar with is the Git model, where you actually have entirely separate copies of the database, two different versions of the database, each transaction has its own kind of ability to modify its own copy of the data, and then if a transaction has to abort, you can just throw away one of these copies of the database. And that's nice, but the kind of fundamental problem that you're trying to address with the buffer manager ends up, the fundamental problem that you're trying to address by having one copy of the database is that it allows us more efficiently to batch writes together. And merging two databases is something that ends up being very expensive. It's going to take up more memory. Merging is just generally expensive. And if we have to wait until the two databases end up being merged together, this ends up being way more expensive than taking way more time than we really wanted to take. So mainly my point here is that I want to emphasize that we are going to be focusing on providing rollback when there is one specific instance of the database, when we're keeping track of one canonical copy of the database.
But this would increase
the problems of Yeah, well, it increases problems of concurrency only if you are using the optimistic concurrency model. Because that's the only model where every database has its own copy, both multi-version and locking. Sorry, both timestamp, both variants of timestamp, and the locking approach assume that you have one global copy of the database to work with. Does that address your question?
Locking, even if you have a single copy of the database, there are two transactions, and we're assuming
an infinite
amount of transactions.
So, optimistic concurrency control still runs into the same issues. The only difference is that it doesn't run into them until you try and merge the values together.
No, I'm talking about even if there's only one single instance.
Mm-hmm.
Then also, we are assuming that the transactions can be.
Yes, so the transactions are in.
So when they're trying to write, and if transaction one aborts, and then transaction two commits, then if transaction two is only performing writes, then it might override the value, but if it is accessing the value and then performing the write, then it comes
into the completely right. So if a transaction, if we have two transactions operating at the same time, we need to be careful about how we undo things. We don't want, if a transaction's modification to the database has already been undone, or an aborted transaction, if an aborted transaction modifies the database, and then another transaction overwrites its modification, we don't want to redo the older version. But that's something that you can check. With timestamp concurrency control, you can check to see whether the current value in the system, you keep track of the last transaction to write to that particular And just like, so recall the technique for dealing with write-write conflicts. If a transaction would write to a value that has already been written by an earlier value, you just don't do it. So we're keeping track of enough information that undoing a write shouldn't cause, we can detect when we are undoing, when we're about to undo a write that was applied by a later transaction. Does that address your question? Okay. So main thing I want to emphasize is that we're going to talk about a model where we have one canonical version of the database. And we're not using this merge trickery in order to be able to provide all that. So the basic gimmick here is that in addition to logging the last write, we log the value that gets overwritten. So if we're replacing 8 with 10 for A, we log the 8 as well as the 10. So then if one of the transactions aborts, we can go back through the log for that transaction and undo all of the operations that that transaction did. Obviously, as we're going through and undoing the effects, we keep track and make sure that none of the that no later transaction has overwritten any of those values. So these two strategies, this is what's known as a redo log and an undo log, because with this type of log, you can basically go both backwards and forwards through time, as far as the database is concerned. So we have the ability to do rollback. We have the ability to recover from to recover the state of a database, even if we stop somewhere in the middle. Now we want to put all of this together, and again, our goal here is if the database crashes at any point in the process of doing the database's normal activities, we want to be able to reconstruct exactly the state of the database at the point that the crash occurred. So the state, we need to, what are the pieces of state that we need to keep track of, or that the database normally keeps track of? You already got one of them, the buffer manager. What else does the database need to keep track of? So transactions are writing to data, we want to buffer those writes before we actually flush them out the disk, so we need to keep track of kind of the state of that buffer is. But what other kind of transient state does the database keep? About the list of transactions. So the database needs to keep track of what transactions are actively running. So essentially the database recovery revolves around these two components, the transaction table and the buffer manager. So the transaction table literally just keeps track of the state of each of the transactions. If you're dealing with multi-version concurrency control, it might be in the validating state, even if you're not. The transaction might be trying to commit, it might be trying to abort, it might be running, it might be fully committed, it might be fully aborted, although once it hits the fully committed or fully aborted state, you can just remove it from the table because it's no longer relevant. So this is basically all of the transactions that are active in the system at the time, at any given point in time. And the system keeps track of not just the status of each transaction, but also the last log entry for each of those transactions. And you can think of this as kind of a pointer to the start, to the head of that linked list of transaction events, that linked list of log entries that we keep for each transaction. So the other thing that we keep track of is the buffer manager. So this is all of the data pages that the system has in memory. We need to keep track of which of them have metadata that, or sorry, which of them have data that their modifications applied to them that haven't been written to disk. All those dirty pages, clean pages are the ones that haven't been, that are essentially exact copies of what's on disk. And additionally, we also keep track of the last log entry to apply a modification to that particular page. Right. So, going back to our model of the database, there's essentially three moving parts. There's the transaction table, there's the buffer manager, and there's the log that we've been building up in order to recover. Let's say the system crashes at some point. What do we have when the system comes back? Okay, so we have the log.
I agree.
Anything, any part of the log, we can essentially keep track of what part of the log has been flushed to disk. So essentially, we know, we can convince ourselves at any point that as much of the log as we want is safely on disk before we do it. So the log is safely on disk. Is this something that is on disk? Or is this something that we should be storing on disk? Changes pretty frequently. We have to, every time we a transaction does something, we have to add it to change its log entry there. This is something that changes frequently enough that we probably don't want to put this on disk if we can avoid it. Although there's one major caveat there that we'll get back to. So this is generally not going to be on disk. What about this? Kinda, sorta. Okay, yeah, so a large chunk of this is going to be on disk. But there's also going to be a bunch of dirty pages that we haven't yet had a chance to write out to disk. So, in short, this is entirely in memory. We lose this completely if the system crashes. This is, as much of this as we need is on disk. So this we can assume is completely on disk. And this kind of sort of. A bunch of it is on disk. Some of it we may need to recover ourselves. So, all right, let's take a very quick 5-minute break. But when we get back, we're going to go through a protocol for recovering the state of the database called ARIES. That basically, this is like the killer protocol. It works. Crash the database while the protocol is running, and it still doesn't work, which I think is kind of cool. But let's take a quick 5-minute break. We'll be back here at 1:19. About an error, blank, 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 blank. So when you're computing an aggregate, you have to produce exactly one row. If there are no values that go into the aggregate, the default value is null. And blank, you can output nulls as blanks in the greater board. That occurs. Yeah. Floating point numbers should be getting rounded.
Yep. Yes.
The in-memory phase, how is the score divided? I mean, you are passing all 24 queries and it's taking around 59 seconds for total of all queries. Still, it's giving us 2.5.
Can I get back to you on this after having just talked to Oliver about it?
I actually posted a mail also, and I also posted on the other.
Okay. I'll answer the Piazza post. I just want to have a chat with Paul over about it.
Because we saw in group 69, second round, more than 200 seconds, still they are getting quiet.
That's a bug. Yeah. So that's part of the. We got to sort some things out.
Thank you.
So we talked about doing logging. We talked about recovering stuff using logging. But there's always kind of the problem that what happens if your system crashes while you are doing recovery? Early database practitioners were super paranoid about data loss, and many of you should be as well. ARIES is a protocol, it's a sequence of operations that if you follow this particular pattern, you are basically going to avoid cases where a system crash during the recovery process could lead to data corruption. So ARIES, in a nutshell, basically goes through three stages. First, it's going to look at the log, and it's going to rebuild the transaction table, that first piece that we completely lose in a crash. Second, it's going to rebuild the state of the buffer manager at the time of the crash. So all of the dirty pages, it's going to get basically back to that point. And then finally, it's going to go back through the log and abort all of the transactions that were pending at the time of the crash. And it's going to go through all of, as it's going through all of these phases, essentially at any stage here, it's safe from crashes. Because as it's rebuilding the transaction table, that's a purely in-memory activity. And if the system crashes at this point, who cares? Just means you have to restart the process from scratch. Rebuilding the buffer manager state, again, this is any point during rebuilding the buffer manager state, this is mostly in memory, and the parts that go back to disk are parts that are essentially replicating things that could have gone to disk before the first crash. And finally, aborting the crash transactions, as long as the abort process is implemented safely, this is something the database should be able to do normally, even if you're not involved in crashes. So again, the core idea here is to be able to recover the state of the database without running the risk of data corruption as a result of a crash during the recovery process. So, all right, let's go through those steps. The first step is rebuilding the transaction table. And in order to do this, we're going to need to augment our log a little bit. We're going to need to keep track of basically all of the state changes. Every time the transaction goes through some sort of state change, we need to record it. And once we have all of that recorded in the log, then rebuilding the transaction table is just a matter of going through the log and replaying all of these state changes to basically get to the current state of the transaction table. So what do I mean? I mean, every time there's a commit or an abort, that needs to get logged. Every time that, once the transaction can be removed from the transaction table, we log an end. And so these three basically tell us when the transaction state changes. Let me ask you guys one other thing. There's one other type of log entry that I'm kind of potentially not including here. Can anyone see the log entry that I'm, or potential state change that I'm not including? So essentially, when the commit happens, then eventually we're going to remove the transaction from the table. So let's build up this state graph. So a transaction can so at some point we end the transaction. Might be in the so we might be aborting the transaction, but at some point
Better.
Is that better?
Yeah.
So we might be in the committing state, we might be in the aborting state. And eventually the transaction gets removed, so we're in an end state where the transaction is no longer relevant. And then maybe like a state or something. But anyone see something missing from that graph? Yeah, so there's no running state. So we have this transition, we have this transition, we have this transition. These are the same transition. So how do we know that we need to add something to the transaction table in the first place? What does it make sense to have a begin log entry? Unless it's committed, then you don't. No, well, you actually do need to keep track of what transactions are in the table that aren't committed, because not necessarily. So. Going back to our example here, these transactions are running. So we still need to be able to detect which transactions have done something in the system. Because these will, as soon as the system comes back up, these transactions basically get turned into aborting transactions. Any transaction that's still running, essentially any transaction that's here when the system crashes gets moved into the abort state. So we still need to keep track of both of those. So I'll make a very quick observation here, you can actually think of this as two separate states. Transaction that's read-only never actually needs to commit, or never needs to worry about read-write conflicts because it never writes anything. And more importantly, for the purposes of recovery, if it's reading-only, who cares? It can't affect the database, it can't affect the buffer manager. So if that transaction doesn't show up in our transaction table when the system comes back up, it doesn't actually impact the correctness of the system. In other words, the aborting step doesn't actually do anything for that transaction. It's only when the transaction performs a write, when the transaction performs its first write, that we need to add it to the transaction. So we can actually use that as a signal, rather than having an explicit begin message. We can keep track of which transactions are active in the system by looking at the writes. And as soon as we see a write from a given transaction, if it's not already in the transaction table, we throw it away. Or sorry, we added to the transaction view. Okay, one other bit of correctness that I want to get across here is that if we're going to use this state machine metaphor, then we need to be very careful about when we communicate back to the user that the transaction is safely committed. So the gimmick here, or the tricky bit here, is between the point where the transaction tells us it's ready to commit and the point where the transaction actually, where we tell it that it's ready to commit. It's committed. We need to make sure that the database can actually recover to a state where the transaction is committed. And the way we do that is, immediately after we write that commit message to the log, we make sure that all of the log records up to that commit record are flushed and safe on disk. Once that happens, once the log is up to date, safely up to date with that commit record, once that commit record is safely on disk, we know that we can reproduce the log up to that point, and we're safe as far as a crash is concerned. And again, because the writes are append only, the log writes are append only, we can do this reasonably efficiently. At that point, we're safe to commit, and we can, at some point later on, write an end record to the log. It doesn't actually matter if the end record gets lost, because we know basically that any transaction that's sitting in this state, we can it is safe to commit to that transaction. Okay. All right. So one additional quirk in the way that we recover the transaction table is that the log could get very, very big. And obviously we don't necessarily want to scan the entire log up to the beginning of time, because that could get very, very big. So instead, what we can do to speed that up is to periodically save the transaction table. So rather than flushing the transaction table on every single update, we simply save the transaction table every hour or so, every minute or so, or every X number of log entries. And then when we're recovering, we only need to go back in the log up to the last checkpoint to get the transaction table. Now I'll note, we still need the log entries, but we're still going to need log entries before the last checkpoint in order to recover the buffer manager and undo the effects of transactions that need to be aborted. But for the purposes of step one, for the purposes of recovering the transaction table, this is going to speed us up quite a bit. One very quick caveat here, or one very quick limitation of doing this, is that writing the checkpoint itself might require more than one IO. Because of that, we actually end up doing two separate log entries reporting a checkpoint. First, we have to signal that the checkpoint is that we intend to create a checkpoint. Then we can actually write the checkpoint out, and then we can write the checkpoint. We can say that the checkpoint has been successfully performed. The reason for this is that a bunch of other log entries could arrive between the time we start writing the checkpoint and the time we finish writing the checkpoint. Remember, we're allowing many different transactions to run at the same time. So the begin checkpoint tells us where in the log the transaction table that we're writing, essentially what point in the log the transaction table that we're writing represents. And the end checkpoint basically says, okay, now that checkpoint that we wrote out to disk is safe to use. Okay, so the begin checkpoint basically says where the log entries, where the checkpoint is represented, the end checkpoint represents that the written out checkpoint is stable and ready to use. Questions on step one? All right, so the transaction table is now recovered. We have, going back here, we have this. The log is safely on disk. We have the transaction table, and we have whatever parts of the database were safely on disk when the crash occurred. So our next step is being able to recover the state of the buffer manager. In other words, all of the dirty pages that that were sitting in memory when the system crashed. So, where do we get this buffer data? Well, we go back into the log and we essentially replay all of the updates in the log in order to get the current version, the current state of the buffer manager. My question to you guys, how far in the log do we need to go? Can we start from, well, I already said we can't really start from the checkpoint, but how far back in the log do we need to go? The buffer manager, we essentially want to look at the log. We want to be able to reconstruct the state of the buffer manager at the point where the crash occurred. One of the nifty things about we want to be able to reconstruct the state of the buffer manager at the point where the crash occurred. Now, the nice thing about this particular approach to logging is that the log operations are in some sense idempotent. We can overwrite A with 10 as many times as we like, and it's always going to stay 10. So as long as we replay the entire log from scratch, we'll recover the correct final value. The point I'm trying to make here is that we can replay as much of the log as we like, as long as we go back far enough. And how far is far enough? We want to basically go when we're updating data in the buffer manager, we basically want to keep track of the first log entry to modify a particular page. And in effect, If we're going to have a page that hasn't been flushed to disk, we can keep track of the very first log entry to make a change to that particular page. So for example, here, log entry 47 is the log entry of the first thing to modify that page since we flushed it to disk. Obviously, the clean pages don't need to keep track of this. So as part of the checkpoint, we can basically keep the lowest of these numbers. And as long as we replay the log from whatever the lowest value in this column is, then we'll end up with being able to replay everything that we've encountered so far. All right, so wrapping up, we go back in the log to the last log entry, to the first log entry to modify any page in the buffer manager at the time of the checkpoint. So the last thing that we need to do as part of ARIES is to undo all of the transactions that were either running or aborting at the time that the database crashed. So before we're recording an undo log, we're keeping track of all of the operations. We're keeping track of enough information in the log that we can undo operations that were written. So at this point, all we really need to do is go through all of those log entries and essentially replay the log, but reverse. We write the original value back, again, making sure not to overwrite a later, to undo a later event. So we need to go through, we undo all of the transactions that were pending, that were running or aborting at the time of the crash, and we undo all of the log entries that that were part of that transaction. The transactions themselves, as was mentioned earlier, the transactions. The log entries are organized into a sort of linked list for each transaction. So you can literally just follow that linked list all the way to the beginning of the first transaction that is running in order to get back to the original values. A bit of a limitation here is that this step is kind of expensive. Going backwards through a file does involve a number of random reads, so this can be a little more expensive than you'd like. If there is a crash during step three, you basically lose all of that undo work that you've been doing. So instead, what you can do is log, anytime you perform an undo, you add another log entry that basically says, oh, by the way, you know, I just undid this last operation in the transaction. And then when you recover these compensation log records, as they're called, update your transaction table to basically remove elements from the linked list of the operations that transaction performed so that you can reduce the amount of work that you need to perform. So I don't know if I have enough time for a full example, but just to give you a more pictorial representation of this, the ARIES recovery process, to recap, goes into gets broken down into three steps. The analysis phase, where you rebuild the transaction table, the redo phase, where you reconstruct the state of the buffer manager, and the undo phase, where you abort any transactions that were running at the time of the crash. So to kind of visually show you how this works, the last checkpoint, you can start the analysis phase for whatever the last checkpoint is in the log. You can start the redo phase for the lowest log sequence number or the lowest log entry that was in the buffer manager at the time of the checkpoint. And the update phase, you might need to go arbitrarily far back in the log, but it's however far back the first log entry of the of any of the running transactions is. All right. Very, very quick example to illustrate this in practice. So just to kind of visually, rather than keeping track of the actual log sequence number, I've got arrows pointing, forming that linked list. So a bunch of log sequence numbers here. So for example, transaction 2 performs a write on page 5, or transaction 1 aborts here. So the analysis phase starts with a blank transaction table, starts with a blank set of dirty pages, goes, it starts with whatever was checkpointed at that point, let's say that neither of the transactions had actually done anything, and then it looks at each of the log entries one at a time. So log entry 10, the transaction table recognizes that transaction 1 did something, and because the write, it performed the write to page 5, then it records that in the buffer manager. Transaction 2 did something, it records that in the transaction table, transaction 1, there's a compensation log record, which meant that transaction 1's write had already been aborted, had already been undone, so we can remove that from our transaction table. Basically, by the time we get here, we have recognized now that transaction 1 is no longer relevant. It's not part of the, it doesn't have to be part of the transaction. Transaction 3 does something, we add it to our transaction table, and then transaction 2 does something else. So the redo phase, we go once again through the entire log record, the entire table to basically find all of the operations that were performed. So we replay the write on 1, replay the update on page 5. All of those, and now we have the state of the database at the time of the transaction. The undo phase, now we're going to go kind of backwards through time, and we're going to undo all of the operations that were performed. There's a crash, we recorded that as a log entry, and then we go back through time, undoing all of the operations that showed up. Now, let's say there's a crash that occurs even before the undo phase finishes. So now we have to go through the entire analysis phase all over again. We have to undo everything. But the kind of nifty thing about the protocol is that it doesn't matter because we've been logging everything. Because we've been keeping track of everything that we've done to disk, we're able to more or less resume the recovery process from exactly this point. So even if that crash occurs, we're not hindered. It doesn't hinder the correctness of the recovery, and actually can be reasonably we're able to restart the recovery process from kind of in the middle of the recovery process. That, and we'll go over, so I won't be here on Thursday, but one of my students, Will, who's suffered through the project already, will be here to answer your questions and talk about Project 3. He can share your All right, thanks.